everybody. This is Archana Malhotra. You're on the new online session, World's Party Baat. For everyone, all lines are on listen-only mode. We'll throw open the discussion for questions from you once the session is over. Do type your questions and send us on the chat. Thank you again, Bomb, for the opportunity to host leaders like Mr. R.S. Sharma and Dr. Kasliwal. Today, it's a pleasure to introduce another leader and a resident here, Mr. Randeep Sekhon, the CTO of Airtel India, responsible for their mobile, fiber, home broadband and enterprise business in India. Randeep's been with Airtel for 2 years now. Before this, he was based in Jakarta as CEO of Hutchison 3 Indonesia. Randeep's been working with the telecom industry since 1997 and with stints in Airtel, Hutch Indonesia, Axiata Malaysia and Spice Punjab. A graduate in electronics and communications engineering from GNEC Ludhiana, he started his career as a technical officer with the Indian Air Force. Welcome, Mr. Randeep, and thank you for being here with us.
Thank you, Archana, and thank you, Rakesh. I think it's really an honor to be here speaking to all co-residents of World Spa. It's a very novel initiative. I listened to Dr. Basilwal yesterday, and believe me, it was very, very informative and very much apt for the time. Thank you again. I'll be happy to answer some questions on behalf of Airtel and, of course, industry.
Yeah, we can't wait to have all the questions answered. So, normal times or lockdown times, work, news, knowledge, entertainment, we all cannot now dream of a life without connectivity. What is Airtel doing right now to keep the country connected?
Well, I think it just kind of dawns on us that even this telecommunication service is an essential service, because if we see this current period of crisis, the ones which keeps the doctors connected, the governments connected, the bureaucrats connected, I mean, if we talk about the essential services working, they are all are using phones today. The dependence on phones for staying connected and managing situation is very high. So the responsibility on us to make sure they stay connected is really, really huge. And when this happened and we realized now this is going to be the norm, and it really escalated very, very fast. I mean, from saying it's going to be a restricted movement to a complete lockdown, which means our regular business as usual will not work. The employees working from home is easy because they have their softwares or they can download one and move. But running the networks remotely is quite a challenge. So what we did is we have NOCs. I mean, Airtel is quite a big network. I mean, if I was to just give you a little sneak peek into Airtel, we have around 2 lakh towers. So 2 lakh towers pan-India in remotest areas of Jammu Kashmir or Northeast Assam, and of course, metros and all the way in India. So getting these all 2 lakh towers, each one has many users. We have total around 310, 320 million users. So 320 million users of India connecting via these 2 lakh towers with kilometers and kilometers of fiber. We have around 3 lakh kilometers of fiber. To maintain this up is very, very important. I mean, just to think of it, if the tower which was serving a particular area goes down, then those people are not able to connect to their loved ones. So we luckily have been supported very well by the government machinery. So we got passes, curfew passes. So our operation staff is moving to fix the towers or fibers or home connections, broadband or Wi-Fi connections if they break down. And our NOCs and all have been moved to remote working. So the engineers who used to sit in a very big NOC in a fashion and then look at big screens, taking alarms and calling people, they are all now sitting in their houses and looking the same thing they are doing. People have come up with innovative ways. They have connected their laptops to TVs so that they can see big screen, all those things. And then they are calling their colleagues in field to fix the faults, and thank God, finger crossed, so far it's holding, it's pretty okay, and we are getting actually a lot of kudos from our customers saying that they are able to work. Now this is about retail customers, but if you see enterprise customers, suddenly for them the business just stopped if their employees cannot work from home. So they have their servers or their offices or their storages at their office location, and then they use internet, secure internet, to connect to their that thing from their homes. So the enterprises have been after us to ensure that the connectivity stays, and they have been asking more and more dongles to connect. And all our customers, whether they are banking, whether they are financial services, manufacturing, whatever line of business our enterprise customers are, they are all connected right now and are working. In fact, they have been asking us to build these pipes bigger because now almost all the office is working from remote. So we have been able to do that, and we find this as a lot of sense of responsibility. And my heart also goes out to people who are on the ground right now, taking their, we have provided them with gloves, masks, and sanitizers, and we check with the customer, suppose if it's a home broadband issue, that is he comfortable with our person going to their home, just to make sure our people are safe, and then they are going about doing their duties. So far, we have got good cooperation. So fingers crossed, all is well. We are keeping India connected, and India is really consuming a lot of data as we speak now, because everybody's at home, have all the time.
That's true.
It's really, really amazing how much networks can be stretched.
So yes, it is a tough time, and there is a lot of pressure on everybody, from the staff who is out there. I mean, they are our saviors, they are the service providers, and we can't even dream of a life without this. And the medical staff which is on the go, the security, and for you as well, with the amount of high usage that there is, I mean, pressure must be really high for people who are sitting at home, for people who are out on the field.
Usage really hit the roof. I mean, we couldn't imagine that the usage can be so much. We have usage which has gone up by 30 to 40%. I mean, wow. We could not think, and I mean, it's not 40% on a small volume. It's a 40, you can say 300 million users are using 40% more. So the amount of videos people are watching, amount of TikTok, Facebook videos, little trivia for everybody. On 22nd, when the first lockdown was there, and at 5 o'clock, when everybody was to come out and clap or use some utensils, this thing, the Facebook load hit roof because everybody was making live videos and going live and posting. Wow. On WhatsApp. So they were tested and we were tested to see that all the use, I mean, it's unimaginable, all the Indians standing in balcony making Facebook lives and sharing with their friends. But that's what the networks are able to withstand thanks to the technologies we have deployed.
And that's how the world stays connected.
Yes, yes.
So do you have a special coronavirus help desk number or a number created for our mobiles for this, a helpline number?
Yeah, so we have a BCP in place right now. So our networks are, like, everything is running remote. Our call centers are also running remote. Unfortunately, we cannot man our call centers because of the young kids who work in call centers, they stay in hostels. And sometimes they are not able to, stay in there, and they have to go back to their hometowns. So we are moving more and more to digital. So for all the Airtel customers or even other telco customers, the best thing to use right now is to use the app of the operator. So for Airtel, it's the Airtel Thanks app. You can use that to raise a complaint if you have, to pay your bills, and to know your balance, or to recharge your phone, or pay a bill for somebody you know. So these are all things. So better, India is getting more digital in this. Like, I think when currency denomination happened and there was no currency and people started using these wallets like Paytm and others, I think this is the time where people start using more digital.
With everybody working from home, as you said, and the pressure very, very high on all of you and on all of us, what is the increased data usage now?
Like I said, data usage is increased by 30 to 40%. And the top apps where the data is really used, I mean, again, a trivia for people, what is really India using? I think the biggest one usage is YouTube, because it is a free video platform and you have almost full movies and people have channels, so people watch YouTube. YouTube for us, the video is the biggest part of the traffic on the mobile network, speaking on mobile. And out of that, YouTube is 60 to 70% of the video. But I have an interesting trivia for people in World Spa, that the number two popular app is TikTok.
And the government is wanting to ban it.
I don't know what government, but Indians really love it. And it's really, really, so it's TikTok, it's Facebook. And then they come the other video platforms like Amazon Prime is picking up. Netflix is there, but not very big users. Netflix is big on our home broadband, the ones which we have at home, to the fiber to home and these things. There, Netflix is high. On mobile, it is these applications. And then, of course, social media like WhatsApp, Instagram, messaging services, things like that. So we are in touch with all these providers also, because they also have to stick up, and we are working with them how we can do certain things to correct the load, so that, like, we appeal to them through Government of India from duty sector, that if they can convert their video resolutions on mobile platform from high definition to standard definition, so that will reduce the load on the networks. And then especially, we don't want that we should choke the network so much that if the essential services want to use it and they are not able to use it.
Yeah.
So we do prioritize, but so far it's good. And I think we should be, now it's normal. It's been 4-5 days, so things are okay.
So does quality get compromised somewhere along the way?
I think let's talk about three kind of quality. Quality is one on voice. We do not have a problem with voice. You can make as many voice calls on 4G network, and some people who don't have 4G, they have like 2G phones or 3G phones. They can also make calls. Call is not an issue. If you want to do social media, that's also not an issue. Video, like you will see probably in some of the apps like Hotstar or something, not a very sharp movie. It will be a standard definition movie, which for a smaller screen size of a smaller phone, it's okay, because you can't really make a perceptible difference in a smaller screen. On big screen, there is no problem. So far, quality is okay. This is what I can say. Throughput speeds are okay. I mean, Airtel takes pride in having a higher throughput speeds. They have come down, but I think for a normal user, it is fine.
And how do you plan to improve connectivity and speed across other industries across the spectrum?
So we are talking, all our enterprise customers are in touch with us. First, they want to make sure that their networks keep running, because their business work on it. Imagine if the SBI's main server cuts down, all the ATMs will shut down, and they will not be able to work from their, they'll not be able to support their customers. So we are building an extra resiliency for those enterprise customers. Most of the key enterprises in India are on Airtel, on enterprise business. Government is on Airtel. All the film stars are on Airtel, so they need to stay connected. But on enterprise side, the government connections, we just need to make sure they are there. But now the issue is to expand them. So we are now working to increase the capacity even further. So we are expanding some connections to make sure, even if there is a further growth and this lockdown stays for a longer period of time, we are able to support our enterprise customers especially.
And what's the current speed of Wi-Fi available to us in WorldSpa?
I think it's an interesting question. So I think there are two things. I mean, we have on our mail chat group on the WorldSpa on this Wi-Fi speed. I think maybe as an industry guy or normal, let me explain a little bit on Wi-Fi. So there is one speed which comes up to your modem. That modem, if you have fiber, WorldSpa is fiber, but there are some customers who are still using copper. Please tell us, we want to upgrade you free on fiber, so you should get it on fiber. So the speed will be, normal speed will be around 300 Mbps. If you are, which is very, very fast speed. If you really see a speed which you need for a 4K video also, it is 20 Mbps. So a 4K video is 20 Mbps on a full screen you can watch. So 300 Mbps is way too much. But if you have too many users, that means you have your laptop, you have iPod, you have your phone, you have a smartwatch, and maybe you have a smart home, you have sensors. So then there are too many users. So the Wi-Fi speed is there, but then the Wi-Fi coverage is not so much in multiple rooms. So sometimes you find that the speed is bad if it is not in the, if you're not so close to your modem. Then it is better if we have bigger houses to use an extender or a mesh or something like that. There are very expensive meshes. There are cheaper meshes also. If you use, then like the room I work, this is my son's room, my elder son's room. This doesn't have so great Wi-Fi coverage, but I'm using an extender here. And it used to be in our ground floor. We live in Villa 6, so it's a ground floor, doesn't get coverage because the modem is in first floor. So we put extender for ground floor. Now that we are living in half of the house, because you'll have to clean the whole house otherwise. So we have moved on to the first floor. So we have moved the extender also to the first floor to do that. So I think if you have problems, you can do extender. Then there are in Wi-Fi two modes, which is 2.4 and 5G. 5G is the speed which is much more faster, and that gives you a better speed on your devices. So I think if you have them, it is fine. If you want us to help, we can also help to get your home covered. I think once you have that, then Airtel connection itself doesn't have a problem. Some people have migrated to even 1 Gbps. We are providing 1 Gbps service, but probably for today, it's way too much. But tomorrow when the entertainment moves to AR, VR, which is augmented reality and virtual reality, where you will use probably an ocular kind of and then you will watch an NBA match as if you are sitting in NBA
stadium. Live in the stadium, yes.
So then you need a very low latency and very high service. So we are able to support it today, but unfortunately the content is not there today. You do not have those matches being transmitted in a way where you can feel the virtual reality. But it is coming. I mean, it's really coming.
I know you're working on it. I remember the conversation we had. So you've already answered ways in which you can improve the connectivity. Are you there?
Yes.
Okay. So you've already answered the ways in which you can improve the connectivity. Any other thing, any other service that you can provide for our residents?
I think I want to introduce, I mean, people who are not using it, there is a service called Voice over Wi-Fi, which means when in mobile coverage, if you're on high floors, if you don't have an in-building solution, then you might have a problem, because once you are on, let's say, 10th floor, then when you look out, you are able to see many towers. You are able to see almost 5-6 kilometers, with towers being every 400 meters, then you get multiple signal, which is interference. But in your home, your Wi-Fi would be good. So almost all the phones, all the new high-end phones, which I'm assuming Spartans would have, they support voice over Wi-Fi. So if you are an Airtel user, and later Jio also did it, if you are one of these two operators, you can just go and enable your voice over Wi-Fi. What happens is that when you come on your Wi-Fi, home Wi-Fi, or even in any public Wi-Fi, the call gets terminated to your phone. Even if you have a weak mobile coverage and you have a strong Wi-Fi coverage, it is smooth. You don't even feel the difference. You just have to turn it on. Some phones it's default on. In Apple, you have to turn it on. I think Apple is testing with us. Once it is comfortable, which is it is getting now, it will make it default on with the version upgrade. So if you turn it on, your voice experience will be really, really great. So I think this is all the Airtel users can definitely turn Wi-Fi on, and you'll find your service will be good.
So, yeah, I remember reading this, that Airtel has come up with this unique proposal, and it's also urged the other mobile service providers also, Vodafone Idea, BSNL and MTNL, to join hands and collectively provide their customers uninterrupted internet facilities. So you were appointed to coordinate all that?
Yeah, so this is what we call as disaster relief measures. I mean, okay. I give you an example of in Orissa, there was this Fani cyclone. Sometime back, and believe me, it was really, really bad. Huge long towers were uprooted and thrown out. I mean, the speeds of the cyclone was just to bust.
Last year.
Then what happened when all the towers got dismantled, then some operator had few towers working, other operator had few towers working. So we initiated what we call it as inter-operator roaming, which means we opened up our networks to Voda and Airtel and BSNL customers and Jio customers and vice versa. So all the Orissa affected area networks were shared. So irrespective of which user, which operator you use, you were able to use it seamlessly across the area. Suppose somewhere Airtel restored its tower, but Voda has not restored its tower yet. It is probably restored somewhere else. Then Voda users could use Airtel and could be connected with the people. It is really, so we have initiated that right now everything is fine. In case this becomes bigger and our powers start going down, because this is not force majeure, we don't have floods, we don't have earthquake, we don't have tsunami, so things are not going to go bad. The only thing is the power could be disrupted. So if that things go bad and we are not able to service, in that light, we will open it up again in pockets so that the users of other operators whose network is down can use others. It is more like a national service to make sure India has around 800 to 850, number 850 million users, unique users. I mean, if you use SIMs, the number is much higher. So then we just need to make sure all of them are connected, at least with basic services to their loved ones in this crisis. So that's the reason we have for this. So we have tested it. As of now, there's no need to invoke it.
I think that'll be a wonderful service to the providers all over the country, because as you move, even within the country, there are some areas where Airtel doesn't work, some areas where Jio doesn't work. So that will be seamless for everybody, even otherwise.
I think otherwise it becomes a commercial. special thing because, but yes, we have opened up. In past, we did with Vodafone roaming some areas because some areas are not so commercially attractive. So operator doesn't have a business case to roll out network there, remote areas, far-flung areas. So then we have launched that certain areas we built and certain area Voda built, and then we opened up for each other. So this we did a couple of years back, and we are open now. We have expanded our network most of the places we are there. So, but I think still there are some very remote areas in India which are not connected, and it is possible that we can use something similar to do that.
So is there a specific disaster operating procedure in place with our telecom companies, or you know, when we are caught by surprise situations like these, none of us expected all this to happen?
You see, disaster recovery is in place, but what happened now, I'll be very honest, we were not prepared for everybody to work from home. I mean, it is, I don't think we ever thought as a human race, yeah, that we'll be all shut down in our houses and we couldn't move out, and we'll still be expected to work business as usual and conduct meetings and do things. So I think I would say that was a surprise element. We thought, like, we have two knocks. We have one in Manesar, we have one in Chennai. We thought, okay, if there is a force majeure, there is a earthquake, there is a tsunami, for example, in Chennai, or there is something big and one of the centers is not serviceable, you can always work from another center. But today, the way we see it, even Chennai staff and Manesar staff both are working from home. So this we had not seen. But I must commend the Indian, you can say, ingenuity. I mean, all the companies, whether they are telcos or something, very quickly they understood this is work from home. People need to be connected. They need to set VPNs. They need to get mobile connectivity or internet connectivity home. And as you know, most of the companies are working very smoothly. So we didn't have a plan for work from home, everyone. But yes, we had a plan for a disaster recovery in case one place was to go down.
So are these networks also secure?
Yeah, security is very, very important. I mean, just to give you the example, I mean, I stick with banking example. Suppose you are a banking employee and you are logging into your bank server. I mean, you are then using internet to connect. So the internet has to be secure and your connection has to be secure. So there is some security which is built in your company's network, and there is some security we build in our internet. So these two have been built in, and making sure that your connections are secured. But I must say, this is the time when there are some mischief mongers which try to do, we call it DDoS, which are like denial of service attacks. And we have seen this coming, and we see them coming even nowadays, but we have put those security measures in place that we detect them and block them. But in these kind of things, there are people in the world who would like to hack into another company's networks to either steal the data or bring the service down, things like that. So internet is secure, Airtel network is secure, and we are also ensuring that the security protocols of our enterprise customers are also secure. Like right now we are talking on Zoom, actually even Zoom is secure. I was reading about it that actually somebody can log in into Zoom also and listen to this conversation if he's not authorized to. I mean, there is a security built into that.
Great. I think that's quite a solace to lots of us. So, India is entering its third phase and the most concerning phase of the spread of the coronavirus. And how the graph grows for us is still a big, big question. How it goes, whether it grows. So, what if the lockdown persists? Do you have plans?
So two things in it. I think one, we are essential service. So we have now full authorization from police. Our guys have ID cards, which have signatures, and we have connected to police heads of right from smallest, you can say, tahsil to all the way to national home secretary. So our people, but we are only making sure only the essential staff moves out. We don't want all our staff to be on ground. It is their safety also. And that's they just move to the location where they have to fix the fault and come back. We are also working with government, as you see, to ensure we are able to give the mobility data of the customers, especially certain customers which are vulnerable, so that government is able to track this mobility and act on it. Because we all know, I mean, from what we heard yesterday from Dr. Kasliwal, that people have to stay put. We have to cut this curve. We don't have to mix around. So I think this is where we will help, and we really hope we can not enter third phase and where the escalation of virus spread really happens. So finger crossed, we'll do what we need to do as a Indian company. But it's as a human being, I think all of us will have to do our part.
And we'll hope for the best.
Absolutely.
So away from the current crisis and into the future of connectivity now, India's digital future is all set to accelerate with the ongoing thrust to develop 5G infrastructure. So the fifth generation of wireless technology can not only boost data speeds, but also disrupt traditional industries like agriculture, manufacturing, healthcare and education through the Internet of Things. Now there are going to be some more technical questions. I'll ask Rakesh Vich to be in conversation with Randeep. Rakesh runs a product engineering software services company specializing in 5G, IoT, AI, ML, and analytics. So Rakesh, and he was the CBO at Addison. He's again a very accomplished person. Rakesh, over to you.
Perfect. Thank you. Thank you, Archana. Thank you, Randeep, for taking out time. So I think this is extremely useful. But let me start on a lighter note. When PM Modi announced lockdown, and I remember reaching out to Randeep immediately, you know, as the lockdown was announced, that I hope, you know, connectivity in WorldSpa would be good, right? Because this is something, you know, as Mukesh Ambani said, you know, data is the new oil, right?
Yes.
So Randeep said, okay, you know, absolutely, you know, be assured, everything is going to be okay. And then he laughingly said, you know, not only for WorldSpa, but for Airtel's own benefits, because their CTO and CEO both live out of WorldSpa. So it will be perfect. And, you know, so far, so true. No problems. We have been having all our calls and getting all our mails on time.
But so I thanks. Must, no yeah. special treatment to WorldSpa. We are treating all our customers equally same. And Gopal actually is not in WorldSpa. He's stuck in Bangalore. So he's in his... Bangalore home, so yeah, but we are treating everybody because people live everywhere, and for everybody his job, his connectivity is priority.
Perfect. No, thank you. That's very reassuring. So so Randeep, you know, one question which intrigues me a lot, you know, India has a population of what, 1.34 billion, right? And nearly, let's say, you know, we have what, 600 million phones, and you know, this phone needs a refresh every 2 to 3 years, right? And we're talking about a market which is the size of 300 million phones, but we don't see any Indian brand in this, right? These are either, you know, Apples of the world, the Koreans, Samsung, or the Chinese of the world. And now with Corona, you know, any Chinese product always will be big scare. So what do you think, what is, you know, government can do and what can Airtel do so that we actually have an Indian brand which we can hold in our hand and call each other?
First, Airtel is not into handset manufacturing, but as an Indian or as a person in the industry, I must say that yes, India telephone market or handset market is very dominated by one Korean, which is Samsung. Apple is there, but only with a elite few. And when we see, it's basically the Chinese brands of Xiaomi, of Vivo, Oppo, OnePlus, and these are one very, very successful. I would say that there are Indian companies like Lava and others, but they are not so popular as these Chinese counterpart. I think I would believe that, I don't know, I mean, you are from the industry, you would know, but majority of all these companies, their R&D and their software is being written in Bangalore, but they get branded as Chinese phone. And I think Indian industry will have to get more aggressive, and we at Airtel will be very happy to participate like this. I would say government should really promote this, because the software and the innovation which is being displayed in these phones, it is coming out of a lot of Indian R&D happening in Bangalore or Hyderabad or other IT hubs. So I am like you, I mean, very, very keen to see Indian OTT app. You can say handset. I mean, if you see all the OTT apps today are global. I mean, even TikTok is Chinese Byte Mobile. So I think we should have our app, and it is more secure because the data will be in India. So yes, I really hope we can get one. And as Airtel, we should definitely be, we will be supporting it for sure.
Absolutely. And a lot happens in Gurgaon as well, very next, very close to your office, where my office is. But anyway, we'll take that offline. You know, we've seen all these various Gs coming, right? So it started with 2G, 2.5G, 3G, 3.5, 4G, and now 5G. So for a layman, you know, what does this 5G mean? Just more speed, you know, you can see video. What does it mean? And, you know, what are Airtel's plans for 5G?
Okay, I think this is a question. Let me try to answer in a very simple way. You see, what is happening, 2G was only voice. 3G was little bit of data, and when people just needed to send each other a picture or something like that. When the content started becoming that people wanted to watch videos, wanted to play gaming and stuff like that, then 4G came, and 4G is a technology which is the real data technology. I mean, the bandwidths are faster, speeds are faster, and people are able to use 4G seamlessly. I would say for the today, the application we have on handset, 4G is still suffice. But what is coming in future, 4G will not suffice, and that is where 5G comes in. 5G gives you two, three different things. First thing is it gives you speeds what are needed for online gaming. I mean, today, if there are many parents here, if your kids are playing online and if they do not get that latency and they are not able to, let's say, they are not able to be as real as they are on a device in the PS4 in their own house, so you will find their game experience will not be good. So I think one is latency. Speeds will be needed once you get into a very high definition, high dense entertainment, like I was mentioning earlier, like AR, VR videos. And believe me, the entertainment space is going to change. We will have where we can subscribe a Wimbledon match sitting in Gurgaon in World Spa, and we will be able to use ocular glasses and see if we are sitting in the main stand of Wimbledon watching. I hope till that Federer and Nadal are still playing, and watching them play as if we are in the stadium. Believe me, that experience will really connect the world to see like that. I think that is happening. Content companies have to bring that up. Technology in this case is a little bit more faster. So higher resolution speeds will happen. Another thing, what is happening in the world now is world is becoming connected world. When we say connected world, everything is connected. Right now, we just feel basic things connected. You have a smartwatch, you have a phone, you have iPad, you have a laptop, and some people have gone into a smart home, so your lights are having Wi-Fi and you can turn them off, turn them on with a remote in your hand or things like that. But slowly, everything is going to become connected. When everything becomes connected and there are so many small devices in a very small area, which we call as concurrency in technology terminology, then 4G is not able to handle so high concurrency. So 5G is made for very high concurrency. I believe, and we believe, and I don't know if you follow China, you see China has so many high definition cameras around everywhere. So they are able to click a picture of a traffic light and see 300 people stopped at the traffic light, them inside their car, read their number, and they're able to see where is Randeep going at this light, he was seen at this time. So this data is processed at the edge and captured through high definition cameras, and so many people are connected at the same time. All this massive concurrency and everything will not be possible unless it is wired, which is fiber, which is very good. This is majority of China. But if you want to do it wireless, then 5G is the technology for that. So I think 5G will really open up the connected world, where we will be living in a very, very connected world very soon. Everything will be connected, and everything would be smart. Your cars would be smart, your houses will be smart, your offices would be smart. I don't know how much of this smart will take over the human part of life, but yes, all these things will need to talk to each other, and 5G will support that. Coming on Airtel's plans for 5G, I think we are ready for 5G. We have tested 5G in our labs. So we have shown demos in IMC, which happened almost a year back in Aerocity. So 5G, the technology is available today. I think it is when it will be available to a common man. I think for that, there are two, three things which need to happen. And that's very important for India. Why did India see so high 4G growth compared to the rest of the world? India's highest 4G consumption, even higher per sub than China, purely because the device is very cheap. Now you can get a device for 5,000 rupees a 4G device which your driver can afford or your maid can afford, and she can or he can watch videos when they are in free time. The affordability angle and the network angle, and affordability for 150 rupees or 200 rupees a month, and you can watch unlimited videos, I think this has to kick in for the technology to be mass used. For that, the handsets have to be cheaper to that level. Today, the handsets are $800-$900, which is not so affordable to this. And second, the networks have to be built. And the operators, as you know, not a very good financial health of many of the operators around the world. They'll have to find money to invest here. And then the spectrum, like in India, the spectrum is very, very expensive. And some places like China, they gave a spectrum free for 3 years and a very nominal charge after that. Many countries have given free spectrum. In India, the spectrum is still auctioned. So we believe that if government really want to support digital India, because connected India is digital India, and the connectivity will be very mass with a very, I mean, very stable 4G network and 5G available where it is needed. And then it will disrupt all the industries, whether it is agriculture, whether it is telemedicine. We are sitting here, imagine we are all locked down, but if you want to consult a doctor, you will have a biometer on your body and your doctor will be able to see all your vitals and suggest you what you can do. And this is all is possible when this connectivity becomes strong and robust. I think this is the world we are headed to, and 5G will be a big play in that.
But once we get out of this lockdown, so changing gears, artificial intelligence, machine learning, these are buzzwords, right? AI, ML, you hear that is, touching all sorts of industries. So what about, AI, ML in the telecom industry, right? Where is it?
AI, ML is being used very vastly in telecom industry, but it is behind the scenes. I'll explain. Like we have, like I was telling, 320 million users. All 320 million users generate a lot of data, which is about their performance. To use this data to come up with meaningful ways how to tune the network to make the network better, it was not possible when you think when the networks were small or the data was only 2G data. But now with so much of data to process it, you need machine learning who can come up with algorithms and give you some predictions. And AI is used to make intelligent decisions or something where tools cannot be used. So we use it in our NOCs intensively to fine-tune the networks and do investment decisions. We use it in our customer experience to be able to predict that this customer is going to have a bad problem. So can I fix it before he has a bad problem? Predictive customer experience. And on upselling, suppose Randeep likes games. So if there is a game movie coming in, can you promote him a game something? So you profile your customers and you do something like this. And this is all possible through AI ML. Just to, I mean, for a little, again, a techie talk, I mean, if for interest of things, I mean, we feel this is a perfect storm which is happening in the world. There are three things which are needed to get this kind of analysis. I think first is data. Now, with so many smart things which I talked about, they are going to generate a lot of data. But then you needed a compute to process this data. That compute was not available many years back. Now with processors from Intel and things like that, the compute is, with cloud coming in, the compute is available really in abundance. You don't run out of compute. So if you put this data and put this compute and you run on top of it AI, ML algorithms, you are able to do meaningful things. Just as an example, my son was studying in a biomedicine field. The biomedicine field, the researches used to take place over 10 years. The vaccine, like even now people are saying, will take probably 2 years to come for this coronavirus. But if you use these data analytics techniques and collect all the data and process it using algorithms, it might cut short these long gestation period of R&Ds and of this thing to a very short period. I think we will play our role, but I think everybody will play the role, from chipset vendors, from analytics and things like that.
Absolutely. I think, and specifically to get over this current crisis, I think AI ML is going to
play a big role. I must say, it will, because now this data which all governments are collecting, it should be fed back to those firms which are researching, and they should use this data to come back with what is where, how they can be prevented.
So another question, while you know, all the telecom companies have provided the pipe where, you know, you talked about various applications, the YouTubes of the world, the Facebooks, Google, you know, Netflix or TikTok. They've always actually relied on the pipe, you know, provided by companies like Airtel or Jio. The evaluations of these companies are sky high compared to, you know, the service providers. So where do you think service providers lagged and these companies took that advantage? And how are the service providers looking at bridging that gap?
It's my personal view. Again, it is not Airtel view, it's Randeep's view, if I was to give a disclaimer. I think when this conversion was happening and content was becoming king, at that time, telcos were still thinking, I mean, you are in this industry, you are a veteran of this industry, you are thinking walled gardens. They were thinking, I will make my app. People will only listen to music from my app. They will watch video only my app. Where there was, you can say, YouTube making video for all, Netflix making video, I mean, Netflix came later, but Google making search engines for all. I think this whole mindset of a closed thing didn't let these telcos move up. And telcos thought, oh, I bill for them, so they will be connected to me all the time because I bill them. Nobody realized that the online billing will come. People can pay using a wallet. People can pay using a credit card, and people can pay using many methods. So they will not need a telco to pay for it, which was the earlier case. Very, very early when you bought something from Google Play Store or iOS Play Store, you used to play with your prepaid credit to pay for it. But that day went over very, very fast. So I think telcos stayed in their reverie, and telcos have a very heavy capex. I mean, this is a very, very difficult industry. I mean, for people who are just to show the scale, I mean, for a company like Airtel, we have to invest a capex every year, anything between $2 billion to $3 billion. And the cost of running networks is again on similar scale. So the numbers being so big, I think telcos have been little not so much of risk or innovation prone. I mean, that is true with other telcos around the world also. And it is true with CMCC, which is the world's biggest telecom company, which is China Mobile, with 700 million customers. It is true with T-Mobile, it's true with Verizon, AT&T, but they're sitting on better margin, they're staying there. But the valuation of the OTT companies are moving. I feel with 5G coming in and the enterprise connectivity coming in, there is a big time for telcos and other players to come in. It will be reset, and maybe they can be up the value chain in this case.
Yeah. So from a telecom technology in India, Randeep, how do you compare us with, you know, global telecom players? I'm talking about AT&T, Verizon, and, you know, you talked about CMCC, which is China Mobile. So how do you compare Indian telecom players versus these global players as well?
So as Airtel, we are very much connected, one through GSMA, but we are connected directly through CMCC and the American companies, T-Mobile and Verizon, more so than AT&T, and the Deutsche Telekoms or Vodafone, not so much, because they are more connected to Vodafone India. I have two, three things to share as a proud Indian, I would say. I think, first of all, the scale, nobody can beat China Mobile scale, because China Mobile has, I mean, if we go to any country, we say we have 2 lakh sites, and everybody says I have 30,000 sites or 40,000 sites, we found big. But when we go to China Mobile, they say we have 2 million sites, which are 20 lakh sites. I mean, wow, man. I mean, it's very a vast country, but they have been able to invest 700 million customers compared to our 300 in India and 450 across Africa and India. So scale is China. But when we come to how we have been able to produce this bit, I mean, if you go to US, if you go to UK, you still pay 25, 30 pounds or dollars to have your mobile connection, and still you get 5 GB. And here in India, for $2, you can get 20 GB of data. Actually, you get 45 GB of data in $2. In our best plan, which is 1.5 GB a day, you get 45 GB in 30 days. And after that also, we throttle you. And we are still able to make some margin out of it. So the innovative way of cost efficiency, I think, is where India is really doing better than these companies. On technology, I think, whether you take cloud technology, whether you take other technologies, I think India is at par. Only thing where India is not at par is the scale of investments. I think that speaks purely from the margins and the ARPUs we have, that we have not been able to build as much fiber we should. And I really feel India needs fiber. If I go to any other country, if you go to US or if you go to China, everything is connected. Every pole, traffic light in China is connected with fiber by China Mobile. While we have such scarce fiber, even if we put all operators fiber together along with BSNL, which is the erstwhile fiber provider, we still do not have enough fiber what the country needs. So I think as a country, we need investment in infrastructure, more so fiber, so that when all this kicks in, we have the backhaul capabilities. And we will be able to host data centers for the world once this infrastructure is in place. But on technology, I don't think we are behind anyone.
Maybe we use satellite tomorrow.
Rakesh, let this be the last question. We need to now. Yeah, the music is starting.
Then we have the question from the audience, if you like.
Yeah, maybe I think just the last question. I think what are the technology trends to watch out for the future, Randeep?
I think my view is on technology side, this 5G would be a one, and the connected world will be another one. And the people who are behind the scene under the hood, maybe cloud technology would be one which will be become very pervasive and allow all these things to come in very faster. Okay. And I think, so this is what's happening in the world.
Wonderful.
Never idle day. Every day is active.
Great. So I think then we'll open the floor for audience questions. I think people have been typing in. Archana, quickly, can you take
it? Yeah, just a couple of questions. Sandeep has left the discussion, but he was asking, it's great to hear about the resiliency. Are there any security concerns we as users should have? And what will be the change for users with arrival of 5G? I think you've answered most of it. Anything you would like to add on?
I think we are keeping our network very, very secure. In fact, we have a separate security NOC, which we are working with Nokia and ENY, because they are experts in it, to keep our network secure. Our networks are always, because everybody is connected, as you know, right from the Prime Minister to who are connected. So their phones need to be secure. So the networks need to be secure. And we have invested a lot on making sure our networks are secure. So I think we should be okay.
So
I just want to check what, you know, there's rumors that the electromagnetic radiation that will happen with 5G is much higher than what happens with 4G. And would it be a cause of concern for the health of people who are around that?
There are two. First of all, there has been studies on it, which is not there. I think the concern what people have with 5G is 5G, because the frequency they use is a higher frequency, and which would mean that frequency would mean the smaller cells, and there will be a smaller cells, much more number of sites. But I think the other part of electromagnetic waves is the power at which you transmit. The power is very minuscule in 5G compared to a 2G power. And 2G, we could put one tower and you could cover 2-3 kilometers, 4 kilometers in the city. But in rural, you could even go 10 kilometers. In 5G, the coverage would be small. I must say the power will be no different than the power of the handset we carry with us, because this handset is also transmitting. It's next to our ear. So that would be still far off. And this EMF has been there for a very long time. Nothing has been proved, but I would say EMF is there all around. I mean, your iPad is transmitting, your phone is transmitting. So transmitters are there. Because of the higher frequency, there are concerns. People, because 5G has two frequencies, three actually, sub gigahertz, sub 6, which is 3.5, and millimeter wave, which is 28 gigahertz. So people do feel that high frequencies will have impact. But those high frequencies has been there. We use them for microwaves now at a higher power, but at a much longer distances.
There's Wuhan, where this epidemic started from, it was completely a 5G town, right?
China has launched 5G. It's not a completely 5G town. China did launch around 50,000 5G sites last year, and which was to put as a 5G technology everywhere. They were planning a very big launch this year, which is now put back, because 5G has two technologies, again, sorry, going a little tech, which is called NSA and SA. NSA is where 4G and 5G work together. One leg is 4G and one leg is 5G. The downlink speed which you get is 5G, but uplink, because 5G is not there, you use 4G. So that is the technology deployed in the world as we speak. And 5G for SA, which means standalone 5G, was to be deployed this year by China. I think it will go slow, and nowhere still. The only country where 5G is everywhere is South Korea.
Can I come in with a question?
Yes, please.
Randeep, greetings. First of all, thanks a ton for the wonderful insights that you have provided. Talking of 5G, Huawei of China is one of the lead players. which are the other lead players today which can provide a comparable service? Because there is, you know, one is not very clear as to Qualcomm does the chips, some does something. Which are the other players who can provide a complete band of services, 5G services?
So the complete band of services, if you ask me, there are two Chinese players and two European players. Chinese are Huawei and ZTE, and Europeans are Ericsson and Nokia. So, but you have a mixed bag, like you have Cisco who can provide everything other than radios. Then you have now disruptive radio players which are coming. So Ericsson Nokia is one big competition to these two guys. We have similar tech as Huawei. ZTE is slightly lower, but I think they are picking up because China government is supporting them to build this tech. But on core side, Cisco is there. And if you see on transport side, there are other companies like Ciena, which is a Canadian company. But on radio side, nowadays, there are initiatives by Facebook called TIP. And there is another initiative called ORAN, which is helping software companies to build 5G radios like LTO Star, like Mavenir, like Parallel Wireless, like IP Access. There are four or five of them. And we believe by the time 5G becomes mature, there will be competition to these big four players on RAN side also.
But is it true that Qualcomm is the only company which can provide the chips? There is no other player?
Qualcomm is one of the chip companies. Huawei have their own chip. And Nokia have also building their own chip. So every company, actually the earlier chips used to come from Qualcomm, it was fine. Right? Now when the intelligence starts moving to chip, every company has invested somewhere to get a chip. Like you see, Huawei built its own chip, it doesn't need Qualcomm. And similarly, every company has no dependency of Qualcomm. Qualcomm chips are in the handset, by the way. On the network side, they have their own proprietary hardware and software.
Thanks.
Vishnu Prakash, I mean, as Randeep said, the software for all of these companies is done in India. You know, whatever companies you named, right from Qualcomm to Ciena to Cisco to Nokia, Ericsson, everything is done in India. So, which is a matter of great pride. In fact, LTE was launched. We started working on it 10 years back when one of my customers joked that LTE actually stands for long-term employment rather than long-term evolution, you know, what it was.
No, that is very reassuring, but the question really that I keep wondering is that why is the dependence on Huawei so high? Why is it that all roads seem to be leading to Huawei? I mean, I'm not very clear on that.
It's not high. If you really ask me, what happened was 10 years, 12 years back when Huawei came in, that time Ericsson and Nokia, being the only player, used to charge. There used to be many players in this division. I mean, if you go back in history, there used to be Motorola, there used to be Alcatel, there used to be Lucent. So many Siemens, all these players, because again, like I was mentioning for telcos, even for these companies, they have to spend $4-5 billion a year on R&D. So it is a very capital intensive industry. So all these companies disappeared or they merged into, most of them are merged into Nokia. And Nokia, after all this, also is having financial troubles as we speak. So I think that is the reason being supported by the government, Huawei is stable. But I would say parallelly, Ericsson is stable as well. And Nokia is also pretty stable other than the financial terms we have. So if you really ask, India doesn't need Huawei to launch 5G. It can launch 5G on its own using Ericsson and Nokia. We are using Ericsson and Nokia. We are using Huawei also, I mean, in our 4G networks. But I think for 5G, there is no dependence for India on Huawei. There is no dependence.
Last two questions, Randeep. Sorry, I have to interfere now because we have to kind of close the session. Last two questions just before we leave. Yesterday, there was a news about a Venezuelan satellite that went off its natural path and caused major communication problems. Is this a unique one-off problem? Can it potentially be a problem for Airtel as well? Anurag is asking you.
So, honestly, I didn't read about this news, but Airtel doesn't depend upon satellites for its business. And we have satellite business ourselves, which is mainly for our DTH service and the TVs which we see. And those satellites are very safe and they are very modern satellites. Our main communication, which is our mobiles and our home broadbands, our Wi-Fis, they're all through our fiber. So they are fairly secure. I mean, we don't see that problem.
Great. The last question, actually second last question, you talked about your NOC operators working from home. Do you think at Airtel you may permanently see a significant shift in people working from home instead of office even after this? That's a big question for the future to come.
I think it is a question for everyone. I mean, I have been talking to my colleagues of that if we can be so productive from home, if a person has to come from Noida to work in my knock in Manesar and travels 1.5 hours, why can't we he just work from his home if he can be as productive as it is? I think the industry's face will change and many things will change after this work from home across the world, where we'll find we don't need to really be physically present. We can have as efficient meetings as we are able to do it. And I personally feel, I have already talked to my NOC head, that we need to have a float people work from home. We don't need to bring them here. We just need to make sure the connections are secure and the connections are robust. And why not? I mean, why do we want to make people travel so much? I mean, I think this will change for everyone.
Yes, and I think that'll be a boon for everybody in disguise. And even the, efficiency at all levels will increase. And that's a big thing to happen.
Absolutely. I mean, if you talk about Zomato, Swiggy, I mean, till they were not so smooth, we used to go to a restaurant or used to call the restaurant for the food. Now with the wonderful apps and delivery services, Zomato and Swiggy, I mean, pre-corona I'm talking about, then we really don't need to go to the restaurant. I mean, if you can really choose what you want, where you want, what time you want. So I think that changed the way we eat our food. I mean, if you're not, you're lazy, don't want to go out, but you want a food from outside, you can order on Zomato or Swiggy. I think this will change the way we work. People will work from home more efficiently and more comfortably. I think for sure it will change every industry. For Airtel, I'm sure.
I know a lot of industry leaders are already envisaging that, and it is going to happen in the future. The last question, Mr. S.V. Goyal asked you, when do you think 5G will be available to Airtel users?
5G right now, what is happening is government has put it for auction, and Airtel's stated position is that if the stated price of government is 50,000 crores for the service, and we are not finding it commercially viable to deploy at this. So we are working with government to make this, because we feel 5G will help build digital India. So to take it as a normal spectrum and government is seeing as revenue from the telecommunication company where they are having so much of financial trouble, it is better they give it and give them a rollout obligation and saying, please build 5G across all, please transform my industries, make them capable to compete with the best in the world, whether they are manufacturing, whether they are financial services, whether they are R&D, then I think India will really benefit rather than just getting a very high spectrum fees from the operator, because the operator will have to spend an equivalent amount in building the network everywhere.
Thank you, Randeep. Thank you, everybody, for your participants and your patience. And thank you, Randeep, for your valuable time for answering such a long list of questions. Thank you, everybody.